So Scientific American this last week had this remarkable headline. Time spent in nature can be good and sometimes bad for your brain. A Goldilocks measure of green space might help stave off dementia, but an excess could lead to cognitive decline.
An excess.
An excess of nature. Okay, let's see what Scientific American is up to, shall we? So I'm just going to share a little bit from here and then show you some of the research that they're supposedly pulling from. There's nothing like a good walk through your local park to unwind and release stress from a busy day. Taking some time in nature is undeniably good for you, with well-documented benefits to physical and mental health. But new research suggests that when it comes to the risk of dementia and Alzheimer's disease, easy access to nature can sometimes help, but at other times can be too much of a good thing. You might not be it, so, and they talk a little bit about, like, oh, you know, we really are getting a beat on dementia. We have some sense of, like, why people get dementia. It's like, no, it turns out they really don't. But they do talk about, like, there is some heritable component, probably. And so in light of that, you might not be able to change your genes, but in some cases, you can change where you live or your hobbies or habits. According to Marco Vincetti of the University of Modena and Reggio Emilia in Italy, quote, there is growing and convincing evidence that risk of neurodegenerative disease, including cognitive impairment and dementia, can be substantially reduced by environmental and behavioral factors, and this may even be true in individuals having high genetic susceptibility, end quote. Studying the role of environmental factors has led to the recent discovery that exposure to air pollution, such as from wildfire smoke or heavy traffic, increases your chances of developing dementia. Go figure. This is also the line of questioning that led researchers to discover the positive effects of green space. Okay. Based on this research, you might be able, you might be ready to give up city life. You might presume that more green space is better and that living on a few wooded acres with nothing but trees for miles around will lead to the lowest possible chance of dementia. It turns out this is not so simple. A 2022 research study led by Federico Zagnoli of the University of Modena at Reggio Emilia revealed that more green space is not always better. The researchers found a U-shaped association between exposure to green space and dementia risk. Low levels of green space were associated with a higher likelihood of developing dementia, and medium levels were linked to a lower risk. But the highest level of green space exposure didn't reduce dementia risk relative to the medium level, and in some cases even increased it. In other words, too little green space has an adverse effect, but so might too much of it. And just one more paragraph from here. This is, again, Scientific American a few days ago, reporting for some reason on a paper published 3 years ago. So what that's about, I'm not sure. So the conclusion is that green space itself is not bad for your brain health, but living on a few acres of land surrounded by forest and farmland might increase your risk of dementia in other ways. Although trees have a positive effect, they are no substitute for a nearby hospital, local community center, and a walkable neighborhood with friendly neighbors. Aiming for the lowest possible dementia risk is all about a balance. Enough neighborhood density to have easy access to services and social support, but plenty of trees for a walk in the park.
Did you say trees are no substitute for a hospital?
That's exactly what they say. Yes. Trees have a positive effect. They are no substitute for a nearby hospital.
These people are well on their way to dementia, whether or not they know it.
So there's, okay, let's just go to the original research, which I'm not going to spend much time on because it's a giant modeling mess. But it published in Current Environmental Health Reports in 2022, is greenness associated with dementia? A systematic review and dose response meta-analysis. It's a giant meta review of that basically is looking at other research that has done these. There's two different databases they're pulling from, but like assessments of greenness, which point one, greenness around you is not the same as nature.
Yeah.
Right? Like greenness and nature are not the same thing. And Scientific American conflates those two in its freaking headline.
To make the point clear. Greenness could be that you're surrounded by GMO corn with Roundup being sprayed on it. So it's not synonymous with nature. At best, it's a proxy, and you would want to test very carefully how good a proxy it was.
Yes.
Because for one thing, when you get a result like that,
but it turns out like these researchers with this ridiculously complex, but I think crap method, didn't even actually get the result that Scientific American's claiming. Not really. So, like, again, we're not going to spend too much time here, but I'm just going to go through the paragraphs I've Oh, well, this is interesting. So these authors apparently are new to the idea of hypothesis. And so in their introduction, is it their introduction? I think still, yeah. They have this paragraph. According to the Population Exposure Comparator Outcome and Study Design Guidelines, the specific research question is, quote, in the adult population, what is the effect of greenness on risk of cognitive impairment or dementia from epidemiological studies, end quote. So maybe that's just badly written, but according to the guidelines, the research question is like, no, you've been apparently it required guidelines to inform a bunch of researchers. So they need to have a question going in. So they didn't post hoc their way into getting the answers they wanted. So like, again, the problems with modern science and part of why, you know, what Doge should be doing is going in and saying, yeah, all y'alls who claim to be doing science, that's not science. I don't see a hypothesis. Stop it with the data-driven. Get out of here and come back once you know what the scientific method is. So, you know, according to the guidelines, here's our, yeah, okay, fine. So, you know, it doesn't give me faith that these people actually know what science is. Study characteristics. Table 1 summarizes the main characteristics of included studies. The publication period ranged from 2015 to 2022. 3 studies were conducted in Europe, 2 in the UK, 1 in the Netherlands, 5 in North America, 2 in Canada, and 3 in the US, 3 in Asia, 1 each in China, Taiwan, and Hong Kong, and 1 in Australia. So first off, we've got, it seems great, oh, it's global, but like, do you think that green space might mean something different in the Netherlands than in Hong Kong than in and where in the US exactly? Like, actually, in this case, I think you want to control for what kind of thing you are, you know, is around you and what, like, what green space might mean. So right away, I don't have a lot of faith that this method could possibly reveal anything interesting. Sorry, on through here. Here we have... In their results, the dose response curve between dementia and greenness, as measured by LULC, showed a lower risk ratio for the intermediate range of exposure between 0.2 and 0.8, with the lowest RR of around 0.8 at a greenness level of 0.5. Like lots of whatever, it doesn't matter. At the highest levels of greenness, there was little evidence of protection, with the RR approaching and slightly exceeding 1. 2 of the 3 included studies, demonstrated a U-shaped relation while the other suggested no association. So they've got 2 studies which show a very weak supposed U-shaped correlation in which they've defined green weirdly, and they're looking at studies from across the world, and it's just 2 studies
and,
as well. And they and I don't know why they excluded all the rest, I don't remember, but 2 of the 3 show a weak U-shaped curve in which, oh, more greenness makes you more susceptible to dementia, and one of them doesn't.
Right. So the one that doesn't raises all sorts of questions about why the relationship isn't there. And
yes,
the fact that this hypothesis is preposterous on its face.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, but again, so I shared with you their hypothesis, and they did not hypothesize that they were going to find higher rates of dementia with more greenness.
Yeah.
They had a two-tailed hypothesis. They didn't even specify. They had like an open-tailed hypothesis in which they just said there's going to be an effect.
Yeah.
Like greenness is going to have an effect on dementia, and we don't know what it's going to be.
So, yes, and that does include the rational hypothesis, which is that likely it would have benefits.
Yeah.
But I would just point out, human beings evolved outside. The idea that we are ill-prepared for...
Right. You know, let me just finish this before you do the rant. The systemic review and meta-analysis suggests that environmental greenness may have a non-linear association with dementia. Specifically, the data are consistent with the hypothesis that living in a place with an intermediate greenness value may protect against dementia. Again, they're claiming a hypothesis here, which they had to say up top what the question was, and that wasn't the hypothesis. Given the limitation of previous studies in terms of exposure assessment, control of confounding, and lack of precision, future studies should address these methodological challenges to facilitate pooled analyses and to provide more reliable conclusions, which is just their way of saying more research needs to be done, and you can't really trust what we found.
Which does raise the question as to why Scientific American, which is a compromised property,
precisely,
has decided that now is the moment to take this research, which is doubtful in and of itself. It doesn't. That conclusion,
yes,
says we don't exactly know what happened here.
Yes.
It doesn't make a lot of sense. And yet Scientific American is touting it as if it provides some sort of guidance about how to live your life.
Right.
Which it clearly doesn't.
So, you know, once again, the headline from Scientific American this week was "Time spent in nature can be good and sometimes bad for your brain." arguing specifically for a Goldilocks measure of green space. And they've made several errors here. And I can have my screen back here so I can make sure I know what the errors are. They have conflated green, which is what the original research was looking at, green, weirdly defined, but green with nature. Green is not the same as nature. There's like this methodological bullshit in the original article, which is complex and stats heavy, and being generally surrounded by green doesn't mean that you're actually experiencing it, right? Like, that doesn't, you know what, so if you look out on a GMO cornfield, that's supposed to be like, you know, choosing to go out on a walk three times a week? I don't think so. And you know, these big, messy, gross in terms of like too large, too gross tuned categories are what big data likes to traffic in. But it means that more and more of the science that we are seeing is just unreliable and wrong. And then it's the inaccurate reporting by the mainstream media, which has this headline about, go into nature, but not too much. It's dangerous for you. And the original research finds a little tiny correlation in a couple of the studies that their big meta review is supposedly looking at, and not at all what Scientific American is reporting.
Yes.
So, you know, problem after problem after problem. Scientific American got me to click, and presumably we're going to have people arguing like, oh, well, you know, I already went on two walks this week. I better not go out again. And if I do, I better slather myself in sunscreen and wear a mask and make sure that I don't ever get touched by anything natural out there, because I know I'm only safe when I'm under the watchful eye of big whatever it is.
Alternative title for that article. Touch AstroTurf.
Yeah.
Yeah.